Good morning, St. John's.
Morning.
Happy Sunday. Glad to see you all here today, and choir, you got us pumped today. No turning back. Awesome. Wonderful way to begin the service as we all have gathered here today to follow Jesus. Thanks be to God. Whether it's your normal practice to be with us at 11 o'clock on Sunday morning, whether you're visiting with us today, or whether you're viewing us online, we welcome you and we are delighted to have you with us today. The beautiful flowers that we have adorning our altar today are given by Pat Dickey and her family to the glory of God and in honor of Gary Dickey's 90th birthday. Additionally, they're given by John Craig to the glory of God and in loving memory of his wife, Joan Craig. We certainly celebrate with them this day. Today is also a very special day for one of our longest serving church members, Ms. Marion Simmons is 101 years old today. Ms. Marion is doing very well. She asked that I please share with you that she was doing well and to share with you her love. Sorry that she was unable to be here today, but she prays for the church and for each of us. Several announcements to share with you this morning. Please note that our Grove Children's Ministry will meet tonight from 5 to 6:30. They will meet in the gym for an ice cream social, a special Bible lesson, and a fun time on the playground. Drop off is in the gym and pickup is on the church playground. Our 7th through 12th grade youth will be meeting tonight from 5 to 6:30 in the Faith Center for a fun night of manhunt. Now, I've never been involved in the manhunt, but I've seen it take place, and it's quite an exciting evening, so we invite our youth to come and be a part of that. We also remind our youth that tomorrow at 11:30, our youth will gather for a Dutch treat lunch at 11:30 at Chick-fil-A. And by the way, if there are those in the congregation who weren't aware that Chick-fil-A is open again, they are. We have all kinds of reasons to celebrate today. We also want to invite all of our rising ninth graders to come for a lock-in here at St. John's. That will take place this coming Wednesday, the 29th. Drop-off is at 8 o'clock in the evening at the Faith Center, and pick-up is at 8 a.m. on the 30th at the Faith Center. So we invite all of our rising ninth graders to come and be a part of that fun night. We also want to remind you that next Sunday, July 3rd, we will be celebrating our annual 4th of July worship service. We will have only one service next Sunday, and that takes place at 10 a.m. here in the sanctuary. So please make a note of that. Additionally, the church office will be closed on Monday, July 4th, in observance of the 4th of July holiday. And that concludes our announcements for this morning. I invite you to rise as you're able for our opening hymn, hymn number 398, Jesus Calls Us.
Hey.
I invite you to remain standing as together we affirm our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Invite our ushers to come forward for our time of tithes and offerings. Once the ushers are in place, we invite the crucifer to lead our children out for Children's Church. Thank you.
words before I lead us in our pastoral prayer. First of all, I want to welcome Jerry and Linda Platt back with us from Florida. They're going to be here for a couple of weeks, and we're grateful for their presence. I also want to make you aware of Reverend David Surrett, who is one of our own, and Davey Surrett's son, has been a United Methodist minister for decades, serving at St. John's in Rock Hill, but this past annual conference, just a few weeks ago, he was voted to go on medical leave. He has had COVID, and it has turned into long COVID, and he is back in the hospital, and Davey wanted us to make sure that we remember him in prayer today. So he is out on medical leave and will most likely be taking early retirement because of COVID. So let's remember these and many others that we know of in our prayers today. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for your strength, courage. We live in a day and age when having courage is easy but difficult. Easy and difficult both because of the complicated nature of the divisiveness of our society, with hot button issues surrounding us on all sides. Help us this day to proclaim and stake out where we stand, not necessarily on particular issues, but on who our Lord is. Help us, dear God, to lift your name high, to lift high the cross, and to serve you. We pray for our leaders. We pray for our country. We pray for there to be peace, but we pray for also there to be love and compassion, the honoring of life and the honoring of the difficulties and the complexities, so that we might seek your will in all things. Help us to love all persons, to be people of kindness, to follow your example, Lord Jesus, that you gave yourself for each of us. And Lord, you gave yourself for each of us, even in our most difficult moments, as we remember those who are in need of prayer. There are members of us, even seated here today, who have family members who are going through difficult times, who are facing surgeries, who have heard very frightening prognoses. Oh Lord, we pray for their comfort. We pray for their families. We pray for their healing. We pray for our country's healing. We pray for our world's healing. We continue to pray for the people of Ukraine, that you might set them free. And we pray for freedom to reign throughout the world. Oh Lord, we look forward to next Sunday's celebration of our freedoms, and especially our freedom to worship you. For you are worthy. You are worthy of our worship. So strengthen us to be your people, to be a city set on a hill, to be a light that is not hidden under a bushel basket, but help us to so let our lights shine before people that they may see our good deeds and glorify you. This is our prayer in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, the one who has taught us and his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. I'd like to invite you to stand as you're able for the gospel reading. from Luke's Gospel, the 9th chapter, beginning at verse 51. As the time approached for him to be taken up to heaven, Jesus resolutely set out for Jerusalem, and he sent messengers on ahead who went into a Samaritan village to get things ready for him. But the people there did not welcome him because he was heading for Jerusalem. When the disciples James and John saw this, they asked, "Lord, do you want us to call fire down from heaven and to destroy them?" But Jesus turned and rebuked them, and they went to another village. And as they were walking along the road, a man said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." Jesus replied, "Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head." He said to another man, "Follow me." But the man replied, "Lord, first let me go and bury my father." And Jesus said to him, "Let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God." And still another said, "I will follow you, Lord, but first let me go back and say goodbye to my family." And Jesus replied, "No one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. The story has been told that Satan was having a contest among his many minions, a contest to see who had the best idea to trip up the church, to keep the church from being focused on our call to be Jesus' followers. So one demon stepped up and said to Satan, "I have the best idea, and that idea is for you to tell and for us to tell all the Christians, to tell the whole church and all the Christians that there is no heaven. There is no reward. There is no incentive for living a godly life. There is no heaven." And Satan said to this demon, "You have a wonderful idea, and surely it would throw Christians off their witness and their walk with God. But let me hear the other ideas first." And so the next demon stepped up and said, "My idea is to tell all the Christians that there is no hell. There is no sense of punishment. There are no repercussions for doing bad things. There is no hell. There is no retribution. There is no punishment. There is nothing like it." And Satan said, "That's a grand idea as well. That will surely throw Christians off their walks with God. But there's one more that I need to hear." And so this last demon stepped forward and he said, "The best way to stop the church from moving forward, for doing what it needs to do in the culture, for doing the work of God, the best idea is to tell Christians that there is no hurry." There is no hurry. That they can rest on their laurels. They can think about the past. They don't need to forge ahead into the future. They can just wait and let somebody else do it. And as we all know, that somebody else who should do what needs to be done in this world of ours is usually not going to step forward. It's up to us whether or not we will live the Christian life. Sometimes I think of this Christian life and I look at this passage of scripture where it talks about Jesus in Luke chapter 9, verse 51, as it says he was headed toward Jerusalem, and it gives that very apt description. He set his face resolutely toward Jerusalem. In other words, he was making sure that he was headed toward his goal, and that was to head to Jerusalem, to die on that cross for our sins, and to be raised on the third day to prove that it really happened. But he came across these three people who wanted to become disciples. And they all three had excuses. It reminds me of us sometimes, whether or not we set our faces resolutely, deliberately, to do God's will, or whether or not we are persons who have every excuse in the world. It reminds me of the difference between civil engineers and cows. Now, pardon me just a bit. I have a son who's a civil engineer, and I was raised around a lot of cattle, as my dad, with his stockyards, ran around 7,000 head of cattle a week, and we had hundreds of cattle of our own. I know a lot about cows, and thanks to my son with his civil engineering degree from Clemson, I know a bit about civil engineering. And having lived in Columbia and having to travel through Malfunction Junction, that I know that there are good civil engineers who are working on it. I know about civil engineers that they want things to work smoothly, that they want people to go from point A to point B in as quick a fashion as they can and in as safe a way as they can. Safety and quickness, expediency, point A to point B, that's the civil engineering plan, and thank God for them and God bless them. But cows, on the other hand, they just mosey about. They meander. They do more than a malfunction junction. As someone has said about the city of Boston, that the streets of Boston were originally cow paths. If you know anything about the city of Boston, the center of downtown Boston, the peninsula, has in it what is called Boston Common. It was a place where people who had cattle would allow them to roam free and meander their way in a circuitous route to the green free grass and free range of Boston Common, have their fill and make their way back to their homes. And because of their cow paths being like spaghettis in a spaghetti junction, the streets of Boston are so discombobulated, are so twists and turns, and are so confusing that it's hard to make your way in any straight fashion at all. So cows walk about, moseying, looking down. The only time they might even look sideways is just to see if there's something in the way. But interestingly, they will take those same paths, even if they're not point A to point B, even if it takes more time, even if it wastes time, they will take those same paths because they're such creatures of habit. And sometimes I think about us and the church. Aren't we creatures of habit? Oh, I love my habitual things. I will go to the same restaurant to order the same meal because I know that it's going to turn out the same way. I like predictability. If it's good, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. Sometimes I will watch the same movie over and over again because I know how it ends, and it's a good story, and it's not going to be a cliffhanger that leaves me feeling like there's been no denouement, no ending fit to watch. We're creatures of habit. You know, what do they say about the seven last words of the dying church? The seven last words of the dying church are these: we've never done it that way before. And we're like cows who meander on our paths. And cows, they will even do this. Even if a tree falls across their path, you know what cows will do with that tree across their path? They will go around it and make another bend in their circuitous route. And what's really even more sad, very much like us, what's more sad about what cows will do is long after that tree has rotted and decayed and disappeared because someone has moved it or something else has happened, the cows will still take that bend around the invisible tree. That's how cows think, unlike civil engineers. Jesus said, more in a civil engineer fashion, straight is the way, and narrow is the way that leads to life, and broad is the way, and I might say crooked and cowpath-like is the way that leads to destruction. So we need to wake up. We need to quit looking about us. Sometimes, like cows, we don't even look at the destination. We barely look askance to the side. And some of us do that as individuals living in this crazy culture of ours, and we just want to run our lives like it's an opinion poll. What do other people think as we look about beside us? Are they going to think we're crazy? Are they going to think we're fanatics? How many likes will we have on Facebook? How many reposts will we have? And we live our lives depending upon what other people think rather than what God thinks. There's something wrong with that. So straight is the way. Civil engineering trumps cow paths every day. Every day. Joe Gibbs was a famous NFL, National Football League, football coach, marvelous coach, but some years ago he decided he wanted to get into car racing, NASCAR to be exact, and he liked to drive fast. I'm not suggesting that anybody do that. Some of you have lead foots anyway, but nevertheless, you need to do like Joe Gibbs. He took it to Charlotte Motor Speedway. He hired an instructor because he wanted to get a feel for what it's like to be behind the wheel of a race car. And the instructor said, I've got a special car for you. It's the car that we use to help train people as they learn to drive on a speedway. He said, this car is called a skid car because anytime anyone tries to drive fast on a motor speedway, when they gun it down the straightway, when they get to that first curve, they're going to skid. Their back tires are going to be worn down so much that they're going to slide. And so in this skid car, we have a button that we push that will automatically put you into a skid just so we can see whether or not you've got what it takes to be able to make that split-second decision that keeps you from going into the wall. He said the problem is that most drivers, is when they go into a skid, they look at the wall, and what they don't realize is where you look is where you're going to go. So you don't look at the wall, you look at the middle of the track. So be prepared. That's what the instructor said to Joe Gibbs. And so they both got in the car. Joe Gibbs is gunning it down the straight way. He's over 120 miles an hour as he's about to go into the first turn at Charlotte Motor Speedway, and the guy pushes the button to make the car skid. And as he pushes the button to make the car skid, Joe Gibbs does what everybody does instinctively. He looks at the wall because he's afraid of the wall. Nobody's afraid of the infield, hardly, but they're afraid of the wall. So he looks at the wall, and so, as he's just about to crash, the instructor grabs his head with both hands and turns it away from the wall and jerks it toward the middle of the track, which is where he ends up out of the skid and safe. Wouldn't it be wonderful? How many of you would love it if Jesus would grab our heads, or even the head of our society, and all of our heads, and jerk our heads away from our focusing on all the distractions and the walls and the destructive things that we do to ourselves and do to one another, and turned our focus back toward Him? Don't you think? That the world would be better if we would follow Jesus? If you do, we need Jesus to refocus our attention. We need it desperately. That's what this passage of Scripture is about. Jesus set his face resolutely toward Jerusalem. Will we do that? Or we get distracted? Will we look at the wall and end up destroying ourselves? Or will we walk the straight and narrow and the adventure, the life that Jesus has for us? These three guys come before Jesus. One of them says, I'll go wherever you want me to go. I'll go wherever you want me to go. It sounds good, but talk is cheap. It sounds good. We say when we join the church that we'll uphold it by our prayers, presence, gifts, witness, and service. And talk is cheap. You know, and in summertime, our attendance is up and down. It's up in the mountains or down at the beach. And it's time for us to walk the straight and narrow way. And instead of dating Jesus, as many of us do, we need to marry Jesus. We need to become so close to Jesus that we don't stray off the path that God has for us, and the world would be so much better. So nevertheless, the first guy, he sounds good. I'll go wherever you want me to go, but he doesn't do it, so talk is cheap. He really didn't mean what he said, and sometimes I wonder that about us. And the second guy, he says, I'll go, I'll follow you, I'll do whatever you want me to do, Lord Jesus, but first let me go and bury my father, which looks good. I mean, it fits common decency and decorum. It looks good and right and makes sense. But Jesus wants us to know for sure that what's best for us is to follow him. And so Jesus says to him, let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God. And what's really interesting about what Jesus says to him, as I think about how harsh it seems, but how right it seems, that if we say we're going to put Jesus first, we really need to act like it. We really need to act like it. In this country, in this church, and in our lives, in our homes, everywhere. Nowhere in the New Testament will you find Jesus ever saying to someone he is calling to become one of his disciples, I want you to go home and sleep on it. Get back to me tomorrow. Nowhere does Jesus say, I want you to go home and think about it and sleep on it and get back to me tomorrow. No, Jesus, when he saw Peter and James and John and Andrew on the Sea of Galilee, he said, come follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. And they immediately left everything behind and followed him. We just sang a few moments ago a song that reminds me of this third guy. The third guy who says, I'll follow you, Jesus, but first let me go and say goodbye to my family, which, man, that makes sense, you know. You want to say goodbye? Don't you want to say goodbye? Everybody wants to say goodbye to their family. But Jesus is saying, no, I need you now. You don't have time for that. Maybe later, but right now I need you to follow me. Now, not tomorrow. So we heard the choir sing beautifully, I have decided to follow Jesus. Three times, I have decided to follow Jesus. Three times they said, I have decided to follow Jesus. And two times they said, no turning back. No turning back. So do we follow Jesus so closely that it's like following a civil engineer's plans that make sense, that get us from point A to point B, from here to eternity, without any distractions and detours that Satan would like to place in our way, without Satan saying, there's no hurry, there's no hurry. Well, yes, there is. Yes, there is. Or do you want to follow the no hurry cow path where you just meander along? The grass is greener over there. I think I'll just go have some. I mean, what do we do in our crazy world of ours? 20 years ago, I was in Bulgaria. I was there on a mission trip. We were working in Strazda, Bulgaria, on an orphanage for Romani children, for gypsy children. And while we were there, we were in Varna, Bulgaria, on the Black Sea, which sounds lovely and glorious, but it's one of the most depressing places I've ever been. Remember, this was 20 years ago. This was only a few years after the USSR, the Soviet Union, had collapsed. And they had been controlled by Russia. Being there and seeing the depressed looks on people's faces made it all the more special to hear the bell ringing over the Methodist church in Varna that had been hidden for 40 years. These three young men hid that bell because the Soviets, the Russians, were going to turn that Methodist church into a playhouse. Sometimes I wonder if we haven't turned this into a playhouse, and because you're playing at being Christians. Truth of the matter. All of us, me included at different times, we played at church. We need to do better. I got to hear that bell ring because those same three young men, now as older men, they rehung that bell, and I was able to walk up those steps, and I was able to hear that bell ring and see it close at hand. And that bell rings out the gospel, hope, in the midst of a city that was just filled with despair. One of the other things I got to see was not only that bell, but to watch the leaders there interview people who wanted to, or felt like God wanted them to, become preachers. Now, Reverend Douglas has just been ordained. He's gone through all the hoops and everything else, and we have all kind of stringent things that we do. Reverend Butch is going through that process, and will be ordained, we pray, in a couple of years. But nevertheless, we have all kinds of questions. But over there in Bulgaria and Varna, they ask one question. You know what that question is? When were you baptized? When were you baptized? Some of you just did the same face I did. I wondered, well, I don't remember when I was baptized. My mama said I was maybe 3 months old. I have no clue if I have a baptismal certificate. There might be one somewhere stuck in some scrapbook. I have no idea. But they asked, when were you baptized? And I wondered about that. So I asked, why do you ask that one question? I mean, you could ask all kinds of questions, but why do you ask that one question? And this is what they told me. In 1944, the Russians took over Bulgaria. And they were in control until 1990, when the Soviet Union collapsed. If somebody got baptized, when were you baptized? The question. If somebody got baptized in between 1944 and 1990, they knew they were taking a risk that might take their life or change their future. They knew what it cost to be baptized. They knew the personal sacrifice. If they were baptized after that, we ask them a lot more questions to see if they're really called to be a pastor. Do we know the cost of discipleship? That no one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God. If you're trying to plow a field, whether you're using a tiller or not, if you are always looking over your shoulder, what's that furrow going to look like? It's going to look like a cow path. It's going to be all over the place. No, I tell you, there's a wonderful poem by Sam Walter Foss, F-O-S-S, Sam Walter Foss, that talks about cow paths. It talks about basically the whole of this sermon and this passage of Scripture. I want to share it with you and see if it doesn't hit home. The calf path is what it's called. The calf path. One day through the primeval wood, a calf walked home as good calves should, but made a trail all bent askew, a crooked trail as all calves do. Since then, 300 years have fled, and I infer the calf is dead. But still he left behind his trail, and thereby hangs my moral tale. The trail was taken up next day by a lone dog that passed that way, and then a wise bellwether sheep pursued the trail over vale and steep, and drew the flock behind him too, as good bellwether sheep always do. And from that day, o'er hill and glade, through those old woods, a path was made. And many men wound in and out, and dodged and turned and bent about, and uttered words of righteous wrath, because 'twas such a crooked path. But still they followed, do not laugh, but still they followed the first migrations of that calf. And through this winding wood way stalked, because he wobbled when he walked. This forest path became a lane that bent and turned again. This crooked lane became a road where many a poor horse with his load toiled on beneath the burning sun and traveled some 3 miles in one. And thus a century and a half they trod the footsteps of that now deceased calf. The years passed on in swiftness fleet. The road became a village street. And this before men were aware, a city's crooked thoroughfare. And soon the central street was this of a renowned metropolis. And men 2 centuries and a half trod in the footsteps of that calf. Each day 100,000 people route followed that zigzag calf about. And o'er his crooked journey went the traffic of a continent. 100,000 people were led by one calf, nearly 3 centuries dead. They follow still his crooked way and lose 100 years a day. For thus such reverence is lent to well-established precedent. Seven last words of the church. A moral lesson this might teach were I ordained and called to preach. I am, by the way. For men are prone to go it blind along the calf pass of the mind. Hear that again. For men are prone to go it blind along the calf pass of the mind and work away from sun to sun to do what other men have done. They follow in the beaten track and out and in and forth and back and still their devious course pursue. To keep the path that others do. They keep the path a sacred groove along which all their lives they move. And how the wise old wood gods laugh who saw that first primeval calf. Ah, many things this tale might teach, but I'm not ordained to preach. But yes, I am. But we hear the message, don't we? Do you want to follow a cow path? Or do you want to go from point A to point B and follow the straight and narrow? The choice is yours. Meander and mosey, or get up and go and resolutely set your face like Jesus. Let us pray. Gracious God, we do pray that you will lead us and guide us so that we can faithfully follow you and not be distracted, not be destroyed, hitting the walls of life. Help us, Lord, to put our eyes and focus on you. Please jerk our heads around so that we don't look at the wayward ways like calves do or cows do. Help us, Lord, to follow the way that makes sense, that's been drawn out by those civil engineers of heaven. Help us to walk the streets of gold by learning to follow you closely here on earth. That is our prayer. Give us courage. In Jesus' name, amen. Our closing hymn is number 467, Trust and Obey. 467, Trust and Obey. Stand as you're able. God bless you and keep you. Make his face to shine upon you and give you peace. May he lead you in his way with him by your side as you dedicated in a dedicated way and a complete way, trust and obey and follow the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And may his blessing of the triune God be upon you and remain with you now and forevermore. Amen.